of a trillion tons and remove upwards of a trillion tons of carbon dioxide equivalent of warming pollutants from the atmosphere in order to get to net zero emissions or carbon neutrality by 2050 and stay under 1.5C warming. As bold as that is, we know today that it's not enough. The United Nations operates by consensus, so these goals are inherently conservative. And the latest science and the reality that we're experiencing in California and around the world makes it pretty clear that we have to do much more. Some of the latest science, we will pass 1.5C warming by 2030, 10 years earlier than the UN projected. And just last week, a new analysis came out that with all the pledges for greenhouse gas emission cuts by countries around the world in preparation for COP26, the United Nations climate meeting in Glasgow next week, we are still on track for almost 3 degrees Celsius warming. We have to do much more. The nation and the world look to California to lead for a climate safe future. We know we need more aggressive and equitable policies and accelerated timelines in California now. At the Climate Center, we are leading an effort called Climate Safe California. Our vision is that by 2025, California will have enacted the bold policies required by the science and the climate reality to dramatically cut emissions, start drawdown of past pollution, and secure resilient communities for everyone by 2030, inspiring global action. Current California laws gets us there by 2045, and we know it's too late. Our goal is to move that up by 15 years. We work to achieve net negative emissions or carbon negative, where drawdown is greater than the emissions we're making by 2030. We do that by getting to 80% below 1990 levels by 2030, doubling current goals, and combining that with a major investment in nature-based annual sequestration on working lands and natural lands so that we have sequestration greater than emissions by 2030. This is a quick schematic of what that can look like from various sectors, from the electric sector to transportation and more. And the key policies to get us there are in these areas: accelerating the phase out of fossil fuel development, production, and use, and moving to more electrification, scaling up nature-based sequestration, investing in community resilience, and funding climate action much greater than what we have now, even with the new investments that we've seen from the Newsom administration this year. Key principles: everything we do has to be based on the latest science. We have to ensure a just transition for fossil fuel workers, their families, and their communities. And we have to prioritize climate justice and ensure that lower income communities and communities of color are no longer disproportionately harmed by fossil fuels and that they have equal access to climate solutions. So I invite you today to endorse Climate Safe California at climatesafeca.org. We can remove more climate pollution than we're emitting. We have the solutions, we just need the political will. I'm very pleased today to welcome everyone for our Learning About a Just Transition webinar. And first, I'd like to introduce our two first guests. Michael Leon Guerrera has served as executive director of the Labor Network for Sustainability since 2016 after serving as the national coordinator of the Climate Justice Alliance. Bringing more than 30 years of community organizing and alliance building experience, Michael served as field organizer and executive director of Southwest Organizing Project for 17 years, leading successful environmental and economic justice campaigns. Welcome, Michael. Great to have you with us. And Veronica Wilson joined the Labor Network for Sustainability in 2018 when she organized the network's first LA labor convergence on climate change. She now supports unions across the state that are strengthening the labor climate movement and advocating for an equitable transition for workers and communities. Welcome, Veronica. I'll hand it off to you both.
Great. Thank you, Ellie. And thank you, Climate Center, for hosting this very important discussion. So as Ellie mentioned, my name is Michael Leon Guerrero. I'm the executive director of the Labor Network for Sustainability. We're a national network of worker and climate justice individuals and organizations. Our mission is to build a powerful labor climate movement to secure an ecologically sustainable and economically just future where everyone can make a living on a living planet. Just transition has been a central issue for LNS since our inception over a decade ago. We publish numerous articles and reports on this subject, which you can find on our website, and I'll post the link in the chat for you. But as we transition to a climate-safe economy, how do we assure that the economic livelihoods and health of workers and communities are protected? and that these communities and their environments thrive in a just and sustainable way. Unfortunately, the history of economic transitions in the U.S. has generally left a negative legacy. Workers and communities have too often been left behind and their environments devastated. The scale of transition that we're talking about, that Ellie just described, will be necessary for a climate-safe economy will likely be unprecedented. We are unprepared for these changes and need to start being proactive now. So we felt that the best way to develop good transition policy is by hearing from people that we have that have experienced them firsthand, are experiencing them now, or will be in the future, and to listen to those that are organizing on the front lines of the issue. So last year, we conducted the Just Transition Listening Project. This involved in-depth interviews with over 100 workers and community leaders in 26 states. Workers came from a range of industries, from textiles and teaching to oil refining and food service. And we heard very moving stories, both heartbreaking and inspiring. But we also learned about how workers and communities creatively navigated these major changes, how they utilized existing policies and worked to create new ones, how they organized and built coalitions and new institutions. So today, Hunter and Eichel will provide two critical case studies, and I'm very happy that they're able to join us today. I also want to acknowledge the co-authors of the report, Drs. Mijin Cha of Occidental College, Demetrius Stavis of Colorado State University, Todd Vachon of Rutgers University Labor College, and Dr. Vivian Price, who will present the findings and recommendations to you today. There are also numerous labor, indigenous, and environmental justice leaders who served on our organizing committee, conducted interviews, and were advisors to the project. You can find them listed in the report. And of course, a huge thanks to all of the interviewees that took the time to share their stories. So looking forward to today's conversation. And with that, I'm going to pass it over to Veronica Wilson, our LNS California organizer. Veronica.
Thank you, Michael. Very briefly, we have a great opportunity to learn about Just Transition in California that has a particular context. So to start talking about listening and learning, we must consider a point of departure. And according to Sacred Places Institute, California is home to more than 150 Native nations, many of whom maintain active ties with ancestral territories and have been fighting to protect the lands and waters within their ancestral territories and undo the environmental damage from the time of colonization's first acts of violent displacement. Learning about Just Transition in California includes, as the title of the report illuminates, workers and communities, often one and the same. In California today, we are already studying Just Transition. As Michael mentioned, we have a burgeoning academic community that includes some of the co-authors of the report, Drs. Vivian Price and Mijin Cha, who've been analyzing the concept of Just Transition for years before we started having more public conversations about it and the term was part of public officials' speeches. The opportunity to learn is great because California is ahead in some ways. And we're seeing a Just Transition movement that includes environmental justice communities, the environmental movement, and is a critical part of the labor climate movement here. We're seeing policy, for example, in Governor Gavin Newsom's Climate Crisis Executive Order of 2020 that requires a Just Transition roadmap, making a transition just, consistent with a report on recommendations on high road jobs. And we're seeing institutions and spaces like this one, but also in Los Angeles County, for example, has a Just Transition task force to grapple with a transition off oil and gas and a movement toward renewable energy. In California, we know the climate crisis is here, that it impacts Black, Brown, and Indigenous communities and vulnerable workers and communities first and worst. And you all are part of it, making it possible for California to lead on Just Transition by creating a space to learn about it. Understanding the speed and scale with which we have to transition and the urgency to make sure justice and equity are at the center. In short order, we'll be drawing the Just Transition roadmap together, and I'm excited that we're starting by listening. We'll pass it to Am I passing it to Vivian?
Yes.
Vivian Price, Dr. Vivian Price from Cal State Dominguez Hills. We're so happy to have you here.
Thanks so much. Thank you for the invitation to speak to the Climate Center, to the people who are joining us, and my esteemed colleagues on this panel. And I'm very excited to be able to present the findings today of the Just Transition Listening Report. And I will share my screen. So let me just minimize this for a moment. And yeah, so we've already heard a little bit about this listening project. And our background question was, what is a just transition? We did have really in-depth opportunities to speak with workers, indigenous activists, as well as representatives from environmental justice, to talk about their life stories. How did they get into their work? What are their communities like? And what kinds of transition experiences did they have? So we heard from people who were deeply involved to understand what is needed. We transcribed and analyzed over 3,000 pages of transcripts, and our findings and recommendations were broken into three parts: problem, process, and pathways. You can find the full report at this link, and I'm sure somebody's going to drop it in the chat as well. Our major findings were that transitions are constant and inevitable. Past transitions, as we've heard from Michael, have unnecessarily been unjust. And I've also worked in factories and refineries myself. So I've experienced a shutdown of a car plant that I worked in. There wasn't much there for the workers, except for what was, you know, hard fought in our contracts. But there's still trauma and loss, regardless. There's a loss of identity, a loss of revenue for the communities from the plants that are shut down. There's a loss of union power, as well as mental and emotional health that people suffer, and their families, from being found without a job and without medical care. The existing policies that deal with the shutdowns or transitions are really fragmented and inadequate. They don't help either the workers or the communities very much. So this is why we're really addressing this, because we see it, we've seen it for the past decades, the past hundreds of years, and we're seeing it increasingly now. Shutdowns have happened without plans. Even when there are relocation possibilities, they divide families. They are not a solution. So in order to be fair and just, transitions in any sector require attention to local conditions and who is at the table. We really urge that workers, disproportionately affected communities, that indigenous groups, environmental justice groups, should be at the table making these plans, talking to one another, talking to government officials, and have a meaningful voice, not just be tokenized, that both targeted short-term and proactive long-term policies must be involved and must be embedded in the process. We see for our pathways, we've got some recommendations that I'll point to in a moment, and that there is a general failure of elected officials to deliver just transition policies. And that points to the need for wide-scale organizing based on common principles of agreement. So we need these talks, we need to get together now and to recognize how do we communicate our self-interests as well as listen to one another so we can build power. We're seeing now how important this is just in the federal legislation that's going on, as well as state legislation. But one of the things that was extraordinary about this opportunity to talk to so many people was that we got a very in-depth look at examples of workers and communities who came together to negotiate a transition. Many times when I've spoken around the world, internationally, in person in Europe, in the United States, people ask me, well, what's a model? There's no models. Well, here's 9 models They're not perfect, but they're examples of how people came together in the first case to address fossil fuel and related shutdowns, and in the second case to make green jobs good union jobs. As we know, the new economy oftentimes does not offer jobs that pay well or take care of communities. So these are two kinds of models that we wanted to share today. And I won't go into depth about them. You can see the first one created a state fund for impacted cities in New York. We're going to hear from two people today about two of these models, the Diablo Canyon nuclear facility. We'll hear from Hunter Stern. And then from the state of Washington, we'll hear from Iko Schaefer about ballot initiative 1631. That was an extraordinary model that really led the way in a democratic way to have a participatory board that would use the fees polluters would pay to distribute to investments of the communities who most suffered from the transitions. State of Colorado, there was an Office of Just Transition created in Lordstown. Workers and congresspeople came together for a grant from the Department of Labor to make a more robust transition center. And then the EPIC Redwoods Employment Protection Act was a congressional bill that created entitlements for the workers and who were transitioned to get wage replacement and job training. And Indigenous people were hired to practice and teach Native forestry conservation. And then the three examples of making green jobs good jobs involve Steelworkers 675 organizing an electric bus company with Jobs to Move America. And then the Teamsters were involved in Don't Waste LA and Transform Don't Trash New York. Two examples on the West Coast and the East Coast of creating better jobs for recyclers and truck drivers, as well as helping communities. And the burgeoning Climate Jobs New York was fashioned around the building trades, building wind power on the East Coast. So our recommendations in general were to go big. We need a comprehensive approach that looks at the impacts on workers and communities, with the federal government playing a lead role with programs and funding. While we have promising state and local models, none have access to the resources to fully fund their efforts. We think that the federal government or any transition policy should go wide. There needs to be a strengthening of the social infrastructure that addresses the trauma from transitions, and that unions, workers, community organizations are deeply engaged throughout the process. It should not just be a top-down process. And then go far, that this should be a long-term commitment of support and investment into the future. For policymakers, dedicated and robust funding. We advocate polluter pays principle and not the cap and trade. We'll hear more about that, that there should be a federal Office of Just Transition with explicit funding in place. And we'll hear about that too, how important that funding and not just policy without funding is enacted. We wanna see strengthening and expanding worker protections and safety net provisions. And here's a lot of different ideas: wage replacement, alternative and comparable employment, health insurance coverage, relocation support, childcare, pension, retirement contributions. We heard from workers who are afraid of the transition. We need to enact strong policies that protect workers. We need to pass the Protect the Pro Act to help ensure that new jobs can be good jobs and there can be organizing to help workers and communities. We can build on rapid response teams that proactively address job displacement and mass layoff situations. We want to see bridge funding for localities where public sector revenue is affected. And we want to build in demands of disproportionately affected communities. There needs to be good jobs for all, clean water, respect for sovereign rights, for example. You don't have to start from scratch. We can build and expand on existing programs like the Trade Adjustment Act to include climate displacement and make assistance more robust, with less rigid and dedicated funding. Now, I want to also emphasize that labor and movement groups can act now. labor organizations can form climate committees or future job committees that address climate change, educate our members so that we're not working in the dark. We know this transition is coming. It's on us already. Climate change is on us. We need to address it. We can't be afraid. We have to come together and deal with this. Environmental and EJ and Indigenous groups may form labor committees. Many of these communities are workers themselves. And to have a chance to really think about how working people share problems that cross the boundaries with the communities that are affected as well. And we need to begin or continue building cross-movement relationships to build power. We can't wait. We need to find ways to dialogue with one another in order to build power. So we need to create and sustain genuine personal and political relationships over time, not just sit at the table, but get to know one another and understand one another. Find ways to work together now on common issues. Thank you very much.
Oh, great. Good timing. I was just going to jump in. Thank you so much. That was a fantastic overview and really appreciate your work and all the co-authors and everyone who participated in the Just Transition Listening Project. Really important recommendations that we hope to adopt here in California and implement. I'm now thrilled to introduce Hunter Stern, who is the Assistant Business Manager for IBEW 1245. Hunter, are you with us? Just there you are, great. Hunter is responsible for protecting the interests of his members employed by Pacific Gas and Electric Company, Nevada Energy, Sacramento Municipal Utility District, and 35 other utilities in California and Nevada. Hunter joined Local 1245 in 1994 and is an expert on state and federal legislative and regulatory issues and clean energy policies. Welcome, Hunter.
Well, thank you, Ellie, and good morning to everyone. Like everyone else, I'm very glad to be here and very interested in all of these topics and discussions and how fast and far we can move this transition. It's something that is coming, and we've had firsthand experience with it. So IBEW 1245 is the largest IBEW local in the country. We have over 23,000 members. And Ellie outlined some of our largest employers. We also provide work and are signatory with contractors doing utility work in Northern Central California and Northern Central Nevada. So Diablo Canyon was mentioned. Diablo Canyon is our single largest headquarters for our members. Over 600 IBEW 1245 members report to work at Diablo Canyon, not every day, but almost every day. Some of them are shift workers. This is a important part of our membership, and it's also an important part of the energy supply for California. Diablo Canyon is given on a given year is about 9 or 10% of all electricity used in the state of California. So it's a critical part of the infrastructure. In about 3 years period from about 2013 to about middle of 2016, PG&E, the employer and the owner and operator of Diablo Canyon, came to the conclusion after starting a process to relicense the two units at Diablo Canyon, that given the change in procurement, and particularly the increase in renewable energy and the changes to the supply and grid stability that were necessitated when generating and using much more renewable energy, Diablo Canyon was no longer economically viable. And that they basically changed their approach. They would not seek relicensing. But there's some really key elements to a nuclear plant, including a highly skilled and trained workforce. And so there was a need to keep those workers there. We obviously had a shared interest in that. And we sat down and began talking with the company, but also because of the legacy of Diablo Canyon, which is somewhat checkered, there were a number of other groups involved, including three environmental groups. And this, after a number of months of discussion, ended in something called the joint proposal. It's in the report. I encourage people to look at it. It's a very interesting and unique kind of an agreement. But basically, Q, which is a coalition of utility workers in California, PG&E, and those three environmental groups, agreed to this proposal to begin planning the shutdown of Diablo Canyon, which was a remarkable change in a lot of ways. And that was then filed with the Public Utilities Commission in California, which is the regulatory body that oversees the PG&E and has to approve any action that the company takes, including the closure of the nuclear plant. So we sat down once filed, once agreed to, signed and filed with the CPUC. We sat down with PG&E and we negotiated an agreement regarding our membership. And again, they were not happy, understandably, and we weren't crazy about the idea of losing 600 jobs and having those people not be able to work anymore. But this is 2016. The licenses ran, unit one runs to under the NRC to 2024, unit two, 2025. So we had some time and we developed an agreement focused on that, on the need to keep operating and keep the units available as much as they can be for the next 8 or 9 years. And that focused on job retention payments. It focused on enhanced retirement. But the overall deal was the members, the workers would continue working there with the skills and expertise that they had until the closure. They would commit not to leave prematurely so the plant could continue to run and run safely. And the company would create the enhancements necessary for that to happen. We set up a joint committee to apply, address other issues, including severances and decommissioning work. But again, the key was ensuring that people had jobs until the end and they could rely on additional payments. And there was also some opportunity to search paid leave at the end of the work period to search for new employment if that was the employee's wish. So that was important. PG&E filed that. We signed a letter in 2016. We filed that with the Public Utilities Commission as well. And bouncing along until late 2017, the PUC came to a ruling, and the ruling basically funded only about 65% of all the money that was associated with our agreement and other agreements that PG&E made with jurisdictions, the cities in the county of San Luis Obispo, where the plant's located, and the county itself and school districts and the like. And this is where the community involvement and involvement of those environmental groups and also the awareness of community leaders and elected leaders of the agreement, because in addition to an important workplace for us and our members, it's a very important economic driver for the Central Coast and San Luis Obispo County, Diablo Canyon is. And more to the point, it's an important piece of infrastructure. So the committee, the group, the community came forth, objected to the CPUC action. We objected, the company objected, importantly, also the environmental groups objected because that was not the deal. Won't get into the details, but the basic gist of the decision by the Public Utilities Commission was, if you don't like this, you can go and change it. And so we did. We worked on a bipartisan basis with Senator Monning, Bill Monning, who's a Democrat, and Assemblymember Cunningham, who's a Republican. They authored a bill. We supported the bill. The company supported the bill. The community, the San Luis Obispo County community supported the bill, and it passed. And the big push was to ensure, this was late 2018, this big push was to ensure that Governor Brown, then governor, would sign it, even though his commission, and particularly the president of the commission, was against were opposing the terms of the bill because it reversed their decision. And without that community involvement, without that community strength, in a very much of a armed link approach, we wouldn't have gotten that bill signed restoring full funding to all elements of the deal. And so again, the community, the group is the strength here. And we are now approved and looking forward to committing and looking forward to the shutdown and decommissioning work, which our members expect to do. And so I appreciate the time and I'll turn it back to Ellie.
Thank you so much, Hunter. That's a very inspiring story and great examples of what we need to do in other locations and locales. So thank you so much. Next, I'm very pleased to introduce Aiko Schaefer, who directs the National Just Solutions Collective, formerly the 100% Network, which works to broaden and deepen the understanding of justice-centered policies and programs so communities of color and frontline communities can better create, replicate, scale, and build support for justice-centered solutions. Welcome, Aiko.
Great. Thank you, Ellie, for the introduction. It's great to be with everyone this morning. Calling in from California, so happy to be here on the West Coast with others. I wanted to share today a case study about the work that we did in Washington State. Prior to my role now, I was the director of a new effort, Front and Centered, which brought together frontline and BIPOC community groups, 60 groups together, to go to work on climate change. In addition, helped to start the state climate table that brought together environmental groups, frontline BIPOC groups, organized labor, tribal nations, and many others, and playing a role both as co-chair of that coalition and also a member of the PAC committee that worked to develop the 2018 ballot measure. And I'm excited to bring this in a morning in which we're listening to Big Oil testify before the House committee in terms of their commitment to climate change and wanting to just express that in 2018, the industry broke state records in spending on a ballot measure in opposition to our just transition measure that we're bringing forward to voters. So excited to bring the story of what we did there. I wanted to cover a little bit about what I think are the key elements, talk a bit about the challenges, and briefly about the outcome with hopes that you all will learn from what we went through back then. I can't express and start more with the notion that our ability to unify is very much predicated on the history of relationships prior to anything that you start. We know that across our communities between EJ and environmental organizations, labor, tribal nations, each of these communities have histories with each other and challenges and memories that we have that very much shape the capacity to work together. In addition, each one of our communities are highly complex and require internal work for us to be able to align around these issues. And just transition, in order to really take on a comprehensive just transition approach, requires that we develop a yes campaign. And I think as an organizer, that's a very distinctively different thing that you're trying to do. A no campaign has certain elements, but a yes campaign by its very nature has difficulties. And so when you think about these relationships, histories, and the type of work that you have to undertake together, I can't express the importance of having people who are leaders in the community at the tables making that happen to make sure that those individuals that have the authority, the relationships and ability to bring their community along, and the deep commitment to make that happen. And I think our success was very much based upon those individuals really making this issue a priority together. In terms of other key elements, is that when we started together, we had to start with a blank piece of paper. This was not people joining other people's ideas, other campaigns that had already been fully baked that we were signing on to. But when we started, everybody had a different vision for what the climate policy should be. And we all agreed to basically throw that out and start all over together. And we knew we had to work quickly, and we were working very hard to do that. But it was very important that we all felt like we had generated this concept together. The other important element is that we had shared principles. And within those principles was front and centered a commitment to environmental justice in the communities that disproportionately are impacted by climate change and our reliance on fossil fuels. We also had to have a very clear decision-making process. And this doesn't mean that you have one EJ person or one labor person at the table, but it was equally structured in that everybody had the equal weight and capacity to make a decision and to be able to bring forward their community voice within that decision-making. So I think those three things together really are fundamental to the work that we did to embark on this really a grand experiment for our state to really build this very inclusive and broad-reaching coalition. Needless to say, we have a lot of challenges. None of this work comes really easy, and it takes a lot of time from everyone to make it happen, and a lot of learning from all sides. I think the challenge that seemed to rear its head the most on our end of things was the unequal capacity. By and large, when you look nationally at funding landscape, the estimate is that there's a $2 billion gap in funding between EJ local groups and mainstream environmental policy organizations. And so in many regards, when you're working on the policy design, it's very difficult if you are the policy director of an EJ group or the executive director of an EJ group that works on a number of issues with an environmental organization that has a dozen staff at the ready to work on climate change. So that, I think, disproportionality was really palatable during the work that we were doing. And so you have to focus on fundraising, you have to work on sharing resources so that you can have an authentic partnership. The other element is that we all speak different languages. We might be talking about the same issue, but the words we use, the way that we think about things are fundamentally different. So it's not only just listening, but it's actually learning a different way of communicating, a different way of running meetings, a different way of organizing that for many had to be new. We were all learning from all sides in that. The other big challenge was keeping the accountability to our base. We spent countless hours together in the weeds of policy design, negotiating, talking, figuring things out. And it required us to not only have listened to communities to come into those initial meetings, but for us to spend time going back into community to explain things. And oftentimes that is the biggest challenge there is that by its very nature, the things that we want are often at direct odds with one another. So to give you an example of that and the power of listening and building partnerships, it was very clear during the negotiation of the ballot measure that labor really wanted to exempt from our policy energy intensive trade exposed industries. Now, when you look at cement, steel, other manufacturing that is are often labor strong institute or companies rather, those are located in poor Black and brown communities. And so for EJ communities, making sure that those factories were shut down because they were such heavy polluters had been really at the top of mind for quite some time. On the other side, labor wanted to keep them. That's where their workers are. They wanted to be able to make sure that those workers didn't lose their jobs. We went into pretty direct conversation about this element, and it was a really tough conversation. We had built relationships. We were at odds on this topic. And at the end of the day, the EJ groups let in. And the reason why the EJ group said, okay, we'll allow the exemption for EITEs is because we had that relationship and because we knew that labor was committed to a transition, meaning at some point those companies would phase out or be able to change their operations to be less polluting in our communities. It's also because we are committed to justice. And I think that that outcome would not have happened had we not been working together, had we not been learning from each other and both committed and building trust among each other. And so as we think about the outcomes of this type of work, there's so much that we have to do so quickly, but we have to recognize that this is a long-term endeavor. And the ability to build trust, the ability to build working relationships is really important. And I think that when we started this effort together, the very first meeting that leaders of color had with environmentalists and labor, is that our reply was, let's work together, win, lose, or otherwise, and let's build our relationship, let's build our capacity to win. And I wanna remind you that the power of doing this is so large that, as I said before, as I started, the industry spent $30 million to fight our ballot measure. They spent $0 to fight a revenue neutral carbon tax in 2016. They spent $30 million to fight our Just Transition ballot measure. And then I think the other outcome to recognize is that there is always some level of backlash. The state of Washington has just passed a policy written by British Petroleum, supported by corporate environmentalists, and supported by Governor Inslee and Democrats to establish a cap and trade program that would link to the state of California. And so a lot of the relationship, the coalition that we have built, essentially broke apart because of cap and trade. That coalition no longer has EJ groups at the table. Everything is at a completely different place now because the desire was to really put forward a policy that really put us back in time in so many regards. And so happy to be part of this conversation. Look forward to seeing great things coming out of California.
Thank you, Iko, so much. Really appreciate your perspective and sharing all that you've learned and accomplished together. I'd like to move in now to our question and answer session. Let's see, the first, and if I could invite all of our panelists to please come back on video. Thank you so much. So let's see, first question here. I believe there's nothing that our country can't do when it puts its mind to it. The simple thing of painting roofs white could put lots of people to work. Do the different unions communicate with each other regarding future jobs for their members? Do they recognize their own futures depend on one another? Maybe Hunter, you want to address that first?
Sure. I think that's whether it's painting roofs white or any other work. We've already found a lot of commonality, both legislatively and administratively. And understand, in California, most of the big bills taking steps forward to create cleaner energy and more renewable resources have been left to the various administrative agencies responsible, whether it's the California Public Utilities Commission, the California Energy Commission, or CARB, the California Air Resources Board. They all have taken big, in some ways, dramatic steps in implementing these goals in ways which we can both do so economically and with environmental benefits. So I think it's an interesting approach. Most states don't do it that way, but it does allow us the chance to take big steps. And unfortunately, the administrative process in each of these agencies are pretty bizarre, or at least particular. So we do follow through. I mentioned Q is a partner on the joint proposal. Q is our representative entity at the CPUC and the CEC. So the short answer, well, it's not short anymore. The short answer is there are lots of opportunity and lots of different levels of government. And even now more state and local, or county and city.
Thanks, Hunter. Anyone want to add to that? Vivian, please.
Yeah, I'll just say that's a critical question is what are the jobs of the future? And the problem is that many of these jobs are not union jobs. Many of the jobs are temporary, they're part-time. Go to the lowest bidder. We have to ensure that there are good paying jobs for all, that there are good paying jobs for the people who are in unionized jobs right now, making good money, and that people who have been marginalized from those jobs or who are in, say, in the care industry, in the educational profession, in public services, also get good paying jobs as well. It's really a holistic approach that we need. And if we just look at it piecemeal or blame labor or blame environmental activists, we're not gonna get anywhere. We have to recognize that we're in trouble because of inequality as well as climate change.
Thank you. I have a question for Iko. How long did it take to build the Washington State Coalition and bring the ballot measure to a vote?
We started, I think our first sort of set of meetings started in 2015. And so then we're on the ballot in November of 2018.
Well, definitely a common theme today is about time and taking the time to build the listening and learning with one another across differences and finding those commonalities. 3 years is actually relatively fast in the scheme of things. So.
It is, and just for context, we would have looked actively at 2016 had there not been the revenue neutral carbon tax already on the ballot and that campaign's unwillingness to seed and to work with us.
Thank you. Another question, what is the strategy in California to get a suite of legislative bills introduced that would together provide the kind of just transition we seek? Do we have legislative sponsors? Will the AFL-CIO State Labor Federation and Building Trades Federation put their political muscle behind these bills? Anybody want to jump into that?
Maybe, Ellie, I can just say that I think what we are doing now is a step. So learning together, looking at the examples like Vivian and others that are studying the parts that we can learn from, not necessarily having to consider the whole case as applicable or replicable, but learning from experiences, listening to ICO, learning from the Diablo Canyon and what we're hearing, ways that labor can talk to labor is really important. And all of those pieces that can line up. Yes, there is a rush to get a suite of bills, but it's going to have to take some of the time for process in the relationship building, the trust building, and learning about just transition. So I hope that helps.
Thank you. Anybody else want to add to that?
I just wanted to note, I'm a new transplant to California, but the West Coast is the West Coast. I mean, in our current political climate, it's very difficult to win without BIPOC engagement and political muscle. And especially in a state like California, if you are not centering the interests of BIPOC communities and all that they bring to bear politically, then you're just not going to be effective. And I just think that's an important thing to say and to make abundantly clear. And to know that those communities are not, they actually both, the polling shows they care more about climate change than people who are white. But they aren't necessarily in agreement with the particular strategy and know that, it's not a community to be taken for granted. They can run the gamut of the political spectrum.
Yeah, thank you so much. Okay, another question here. A lot of folks are enamored with cap and trade. What are the pros and cons? Vivian, you want to jump in on that?
Well, I'll just start. I think ICO raised that as an important point, and we found that in our report as well. Cap and trade is a way to continue polluting communities. It's a way to say, let the polluters off the hook by having them invest in other kinds of decarbonization tactics, but allow polluters to remain in business. That doesn't solve our problems. And most of the time, low-income people, oftentimes BIPOC communities, are the ones who suffer. We need to go beyond cap and trade. Cap and trade is a way to avoid the problem and really kick the can down the curb. It's something that people tried and failed, I think, at dealing with climate change and environmental pollution, environmental justice. Maybe ICO could say a little bit more about that too.
I think you did a great job, Vivian. The only thing I'd add is, the policy was developed by industry or with corporate environmentalists and industry in the state of Washington. The initial drafting of the policy came from British Petroleum and Shell. So it matters where the policy comes from. And in this case, I think it speaks volumes.
I get to add maybe just a couple of points to that as well. So just like Vivian and ICO have pointed out, it does allow the polluters to continue polluting at the source. And then on the other side, also in terms of communities where these credits are coming from. It creates tensions, divisions, and exploitation of many indigenous communities, for instance, where their lands are being bought up or taken over to be these carbon sinks. And so that's also problematic in terms of how it's having the impact on the other end of the cap and trade equation. And then the last part of it is also just about the monitoring. How are they actually accounting for those credits and making sure that, these goals are being met. And what we found is that's been lacking in terms of being able to actually quantify what's actually being, pollution is actually being reduced.
Thank you, Michael. Another question here. Much of this conversation is focused on labor. Are there groups or policy focused on replacing public revenue that will be lost when energy extraction intensive industries leave communities as we transition to a clean energy economy?
So one example in the report was the Huntley facility in Buffalo, New York, where or near Buffalo. And that was an example several years ago where community organizations and labor came together with the teachers union because they were afraid when the coal power plant in that community was shut down, that education would not be funded anymore or be in bad shape. So it began with a conversation across interests, and then it spread to people being trained to talk door to door to one another. And they had large meetings in the town of how do we create a plan? And this resulted in a policy, a bill that was set aside to help all impacted communities in New York who had a lack of revenue. So it's a model, again, not perfect, not with the resources that are needed. We also need to figure out investment plans for replacing those revenue producing facilities.
Thank you, Vivian. What can policymakers do to statewide to strengthen the safety net for energy workers that are displaced due to environmental factors, specifically wage insurance and wage replacement policies that have worked in the past? Hunter, you want to address that?
Yeah, just quickly. I think some of the elements that we came up with in our agreement with PG&E on the closure of Diablo Canyon, it fits perfectly into whether you want to call it a model or an outline. The opportunity for people to work, to use their skills in similar but different employers is helpful. I mean, a trained nuclear tech, it can probably work in any industrial environment in the country. They have that level of skill. And electrical and equipment operations. So there, those are opportunities that can be done. And I think the other real benefit is, and whether we can do it in as a state or we have to rely on the federal government, there should be some funding for the transition for enhanced retirement. In other words, getting people to reach the retirement age, whether they work the full, 30 years or not, depending on what the retirement plan is. That is probably another key element so that people will get what they expected to get, even though their jobs have been ended through no fault of their own.
Yeah, thank you, Hunter. God, Michael, please.
Yeah, so at the end of the day, it comes down to political will. And because it is going to take investment, it is going to take resources for the job creation, and the jobs have to be where people are at. So, and they have to be, training and education has to be relevant to workers so that they're getting jobs that actually exist and not getting training and there's no job on the other end. And then the safety nets have to be there. I think that's something that one of the key takeaways from the report was, regardless, even you can create the jobs, but you also need to have safety nets to allow workers to be able to make that transition and make sure that they're protected and supported throughout the process. So really, it's it is a holistic approach that we have to take to just transition that looks at all of these aspects and making sure that workers and communities are treated as people and not as stranded assets.
Oh, that's great. Thank you very much. There's a push to electrify buildings, residential and commercial across California. What's the best way to start on this? And what should municipalities fund? And how are we going to create union jobs while we're also losing other kinds of jobs? How do we balance all that?
So I can mention quickly that there is a, the push is being jointly created, I guess, or driven with the building trades and select cities and counties, but particularly cities. I think the real missing link is the funding. We're not sure exactly where that money is going to come from, but if cities can contribute or if counties can contribute to building electrification, there is an outline or a model of how that can be done by workers, and particularly how those plumbers on the customer side and then what's less clear is how our members that provide the gas, which is going away to those customers on the utility side, how they can be taken care of. And that was addressed earlier as well. So, but there is an approach that seems to, I think, cover most of the bases. And I know I think the city of Berkeley is taking it up today, actually. So we'll just see how that can work. But I know that there's been a lot of work done to make that start, at least starting out.
Oh, that's great. Thank you so much, Hunter. I have one, there are a lot of great questions here. We clearly should have scheduled more time just for Q&A, but I'll do one last question here. What is the best way to broker an agreement when labor and environmental justice groups are at odds on an issue of policy like carbon capture and storage? That's a huge flashpoint for us here in California policymaking. Don't be shy.
Well, I'm sure everybody's got a lot to say about this, but I think if you look at the example, for instance, both that Hunter and Aiko presented, one of the real keys is creating safe spaces to have hard conversations, right? So that people come in with an orientation of problem solving and figuring out how they can work it out, you can come up with the best solutions rather than coming in with something that's half or fully baked and then people have to react to that.
Yeah.
Thank you. I would add, we've been engaged in some discussions at the federal level. If the feds come through with a structure, in other words, funding, it can change that cost equation so that it's no longer not competitive. And then the question is how effective is it? You know, and there's a pilot that's running now, I believe, or is going to start around carbon capture sequestration combined cycle gas plants, which has not been done anywhere in the country, and that's going to run in California.
Aiko, you want to have the last word on this?
Just echoing the point, lots of conversation, lots of listening. I mean, at the end of the day, we share mutual interests. It's just a complicated path to move forward to together. And the more that we spend time together, the more that we dig in and do the work, the more we'll nail it. This conversation is our Achilles heel, jobs versus the environment. I started my environmental career in Michigan in the 1990s. We have not tackled this question well. You'll see it again. Watch the House hearing today. Again, our Achilles heel, you know, taken us all down. And I think that people need to dig in and really figure this out. It is not a, hey, you work here, go work somewhere else that's better and cleaner. I wish it were that simple. Mm-hmm. Not how it works for none of us, really, whatever profession you're in. We want to support our families, have meaningful work, and be able to save the planet. And I think we can do that.
Thank you so much. We're going to have to wrap up. We're right at 11, but rather than me summarizing everything, we're just so grateful for all of our panelists today and all the work that you do every day to make a difference for our future, for our communities, for our workers. And so I want to go around and ask each of you to say one word to leave us with inspiration. Start with Vivian.
There's so many great projects going on right now, but the biggest project that I think that we can undertake is working with our communities, working with our members, working with our coworkers to have these hard conversations and understand that we need each other to build power. Thanks.
Thank you. Hunter.
Keep trying stuff. Just keep trying stuff, whether, you know, whether we know it works or it's a lark, but we need to try.
Thank you so much. Michael.
Yeah, it's one word, it's commitment. We got to be committed to it.
Thank you. And Aiko.
I can't quite do one word, but I can do center justice. I'll put a hyphen in the middle, make it one word.
Thank you so much. Really grateful to all of you and look forward to hopefully engaging all of you in conversation and community so that we can address this issue here in California and beyond. Really grateful. Just want to let everybody know the Climate Center's next coming attraction, if you will, webinar is the Human and Economic Costs of Climate Inaction, which will be November 18th from 10 to 11:30 a.m. We hope you can join us. You can find all of our webinars and information at our website, theclimatecenter.org. I want to thank Labor Network for Sustainability for co-hosting this with us today. And again, thanks to all of our outstanding panelists and to our staff who work behind the scenes, Barry and Nina, for helping to make this work smoothly today. Thank you all. Be well, and we look forward to partnering together to solve these huge issues and make a climate-safe future for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.